coronavirus, or now more appropriately, it's called SARS-CoV-2. That's the name of the virus that's responsible for the COVID-19 outbreak. Wuhan, China is the epicenter of this epidemic, but some experts like Dr. Anthony Fauci of formerly the CDC, now NIH, is saying that we're on the verge of a pandemic. Now, before I get to the autopsy results of this patient with COVID-19 illness, it's important to understand the context of the numbers that we're talking about. It's important to understand the total number of people infected, how many people have pneumonia, how many people have ARDS, and how many people have died. When looking at the numbers, we should realize that they're almost certainly being underreported in China, and there's multiple reasons for this, but I'm not going to get into that right now. Although these numbers are not concrete numbers, it's what we have to go by at this point. Also, up to this point, there hasn't been any pathology reported on the disease because of limited access to autopsy and biopsy results. So these are the latest numbers as of February 18th, 5:53 p.m. That's when I'm recording this video. So the total number of confirmed cases, 75,152. Vast majority are in mainland China. On the Diamond Princess cruise ship, they had 542 cases. That brought in 14 new cases to the U.S. Previously, the U.S. was 15, but now it's 14 plus 15 gives you 29. The total number of deaths so far, 2,007. Total number of recovered, 14,352. Now, based on the number of studies that are out there, about 15 to 20% or so of infected patients have pneumonia. And the number for ARDS is less than that, because not all the pneumonia patients are getting ARDS. That number's probably around 5% would be my guess. So the number of deaths would be even less than that 5%, and that percentage is calculated to be around 2% or so, but again, we don't have all the numbers, these aren't concrete numbers, and these are estimates. So new studies are coming out this week, and we're going to learn a lot more about this virus. But finally, we now have a new case report study in Lancet Respiratory Medicine. This was published February 17th, and this has autopsy results for a patient who actually died of COVID-19. So this case is based on pathological findings of COVID-19 associated with acute respiratory distress syndrome, or ARDS for short. The patient is a 50-year-old man from China who visited Wuhan January 8th to January 12th. On January 14th, he developed a dry cough and some mild chills, so this is considered day one of his illness. However, he didn't initially seek medical attention, and he kept working until January 21st. He then went to a medical clinic on January 21st because by that time, he had developing worsening symptoms. He had fever, chills, fatigue, cough, and shortness of breath. So here's his chest x-ray when he first presented. On January 22nd, day 9 of his illness, the Beijing Centers for Disease Control confirmed by reverse transcriptase real-time PCR assay that the patient had COVID-19. He was immediately admitted to the isolation ward and received supplemental oxygen through a face mask. This is not the actual patient, but I wanted to give you a visual of what I'm talking about here. He was given several different medications, which included inhaled version of interferon alpha 2b, Iopinavir plus ritonavir as antiviral therapy, and moxifloxacin to prevent secondary bacterial infection. He was also given a steroid, methylprednisolone, also known as solumedrol, to attenuate lung inflammation, and more on this in a little bit. Now let's take a look at his lab results so far. You may notice that his WBC count, his white blood cell count, is low, and specifically his lymphocytes are low. And this is what we call lymphopenia. This is not uncommon with some viral infections. Some other labs that stood out here are elevated AST and elevated LDH. The elevated AST indicates some kind of liver injury. There's lots of different causes of that, including viral infections, including medication. On day 12 of his illness, after his initial presentation, his symptoms did not improve other than his fever, but he was given medication for that, presumably acetaminophen. His chest x-ray on day 12 showed progressive bilateral infiltrates. He repeatedly refused ventilator support in the intensive care unit, apparently because he had claustrophobia and therefore he absolutely refused to be intubated. So instead of being intubated with mechanical ventilation, he received high flow nasal cannula oxygen therapy. The amount was 60% concentration with a flow rate of 40 liters per minute. So he's not maxed out on the high flow nasal cannula settings at this point. On day 13 of his illness, his symptoms had still not improved, but oxygen saturation remained above 95%. Generally speaking, you want the oxygen saturation to be above 92%, maybe above 94%, but that's a generalization. Now, fast forward to day 14 of his illness, and his shortness of breath and oxygen saturation worsened despite receiving high-flow nasal cannula oxygen therapy that was turned up to the max with 100% concentration and a flow rate of 40 liters per minute. His oxygen saturation decreased to 60%, and the patient had a cardiac arrest. At that point, he was intubated with mechanical ventilation during his cardiac arrest, where he was having chest compressions and he was given epinephrine. Unfortunately, they weren't able to revive him. They soon did an autopsy after his death, and the biopsy samples were taken from his heart, from his liver, and from his lung. His heart was essentially normal. The liver biopsy of this patient showed moderate microvascular steatosis and mild lobular and portal activity, indicating that this injury could have been from the virus itself, the SARS-CoV-2 virus, or it could be from medication effect, or it could be a combination of both. And now to the lung biopsy. Histological examination of lung tissue showed diffuse alveolar damage with cellular fibromyxoid exudates, along with desquamation of pneumocytes and hyaline membrane formation. Now that's a lot of medical jargon. These findings are consistent with acute respiratory distress syndrome. Interstitial mononuclear inflammatory infiltrates dominated by lymphocytes were found in both lungs. There were multinucleated syncytial cells and atypical large alveoli characterized with prominent nucleoli consistent with cytopathic viral-like changes. So in English, basically the findings were consistent with viral infection in the alveolar areas. These pathological features of COVID-19 greatly resemble those of the SARS and MERS coronaviruses. Now let's talk about giving someone methylprednisolone or solumedrol for acute lung infection. It's typically reserved for someone who has severe ARDS, which this patient ended up having. It's somewhat difficult to tell exactly when he developed ARDS because you need certain criteria, but it appears he went into ARDS around day 12 of his illness. His chest x-ray on day 8, day 10, and day 12 are here. You'll notice that on day 12, it's pretty obvious that he has bilateral patchy opacities, meaning bilateral fluffy infiltrates. Part of the other criteria for ARDS is having a low PaO2 to FiO2 ratio. Essentially, this is a measure of the ratio of the amount of oxygen you inhale compared to the amount of oxygen you end up getting into your blood. A low ratio indicates that the lungs are doing a poor job of moving the oxygen from the air you inhale into your bloodstream. Patients with ARDS have a ratio of less than 300, and severe ARDS is when it's less than 100. It's a little bit hard to determine this patient's ratio based on the limited details in this case report, but it can be safe to assume that his ARDS was severe before his death based on his oxygenation levels. Check out my video on ARDS for a deep dive into how we diagnose and manage patients with ARDS. Now, this patient refused a breathing tube with mechanical ventilation. If he was intubated sooner rather than later, would that have changed the outcome? It's hard to know. It's possible he still would have had the same outcome, but I can tell you that his chances of survival would have been higher had he been intubated sooner rather than later. And the reason is we can do things that have proven to reduce mortality in patients with severe ARDS. Like this patient, I do occasionally have patients who need intubation, but they refuse it unless they stop breathing and or their heart stops. They say, well, if I stop breathing and my heart stops, then go ahead and do CPR and put the breathing tube in. But short of that, I don't want the breathing tube. I explain to them that the prognosis is better if we intubate you sooner rather than later. Most patients at that point have to decide, or a family member will decide for them if they can't make decisions on their own. They have to decide whether they want to be a DNI, meaning do not intubate, or do they want the breathing tube? The patient in this case didn't get intubated until after his breathing and his heart stopped. When you get to that point, the prognosis is essentially zero. Now, there are more and more studies coming out this week about COVID-19, and they're coming from credible medical journals like the New England Journal of Medicine, Lancet, Nature, JAMA, and others. So I'm gonna be on the lookout for these studies. If there's a particular COVID-19 topic you want me to make a video on, let me know in the comments below and I'll do my best to make a video on that. So if you like this video, it would help me if you clicked on that like button. And if you want to see more videos from me, click on the subscribe button. And if you want to be notified of when my next video comes out, hit that bell button. See you in the next one.